Nudged presents Longbow Girl by Linda Davies, narrated by Emily Wilden. Chapter 1. Mary Owen saw a dark figure vault over the ancient boundary wall between her family's farm and the Black Castle. The old enemy, trespassing on her land again, coming her way. She was alone, but she had her longbow, an ancient weapon of war that had won battles and saved kings for 1,000 years, and was still lethal today. In her hands, at least. Armed with this simple stave of wood, only just taller than her, and primed by a decade of training, she always felt more powerful, alive, ready. She knocked an arrow onto her string, drew back the bow to its quivering full extension, and eyed the approaching figure. Too far away to recognize, but close enough to hit. She imagined all her ancestors, the longbowmen of Nanteos, lining up like ghosts behind her, willing her on. She loosed her arrow. It scythed through the air, embedding itself in the straw target with a deep thud, dead center. The approaching figure stopped, weary now. Mary smiled and shot another 9 arrows into the colored rings of the target. "What are you doing here?" she called. Lord James de Courcy grinned, though his face was troubled. "Nice to see you too. Thanks for not shooting me." "I thought about it. Might shoot your father if he gets on the wrong side of the wall." James blew out a breath. "I heard about what happened, Mary. I am so sorry." "Not your fault," Mary replied, gripping her bow tight as the memories rushed back. It had happened just 2 weeks before, but she wondered if she'd ever forget it. Her stallion, Zulu, galloping for his life across the open land of their farm, hurtling towards the old stone wall of the boundary, the Earl de Courcy's wolfhounds closing in. Zulu launching himself, hitting unyielding stone, twisting, spinning, and crashing to the ground, thrashing hooves. The terrible baying of the pack. "Your father's to blame," Mary continued grimly, "for not training his wolfhounds properly. They attacked the Joneses' sheep 6 months ago. Everyone knows they've gone feral except him. Can't bear to have his pedigree dogs locked up or put down." James shook his head, looked miserable and guilty, even though the guilt was not his. Mary didn't know if his father had offered any compensation, but her own Dar would have been too proud to accept it, even if he had. "So, why aren't you at boarding school then?" Mary asked, after an awkward pause. "I didn't think your Easter halls had started yet." "Suspended." Oh. Mary could only imagine the reaction of James's parents. "Don't ask," said James, voice clipped. "I just want to forget about it for a bit. Why aren't you bent over a book?" "Homeschooling's much more efficient than normal school," replied Mary. "You can get a lot done in the mornings, if you start early enough. I always have Friday afternoons free." "Lucky you," replied James sourly. He glanced at her bow. "No way," said Mary, reading his mind. "My father'd skin me if I let you have a go. And don't think you'd get off lightly either." "Yeah, on second thoughts." Mary's father, Caradoc Owen was a skilled soldier who'd done 8 years in the Special Forces, the SAS, no less. No one with any sense got on the wrong side of him. "I've got a better idea," said Mary. "There's a load of your footballs festering in the barn. Everyone's out," she added. James nodded, relieved. He got on all right with Mary's parents, but he was still a de Courcy, and the latest outrage didn't exactly help. Mary watched him jog to the old stone barn. There was something different about him, she thought. He looked older, taller, but there was a new edge to him. They were both 15, and their lives were changing. But he was still her best friend, her oldest friend, even though their families had been enemies for nearly 700 years. Their friendship had survived their parents' enmity, his sister Lady Alicia's jealousy. Survived too the accident Mary'd had at the age of 12, when her longbow had snapped at full draw, shearing back into her left eye. The air ambulance had come for her, but too late to save the eye. So she wore a patch to cover it, which gave her something of a piratical air. She'd been impossible in those early days, when she'd thought the loss of her eye meant the end of her dreams. She'd shouted and yelled and tried to push everyone away. But James had stuck with her. He'd told her she looked like a true warrior princess. He'd encouraged her to take up the new longbow her father had made for her. Reminded her that she was still the longbow girl. And he'd kept her company in the long, cold hours when she'd trained like fury, till she was better with one eye than she'd ever been with two. She and James had always shared a love of the wild terrain that was their home. On foot, bike, and horseback, they'd explored the 500 acres of the Owens farm, the 10,000 acres of the de Courcy estates, and the encircling ice-carved mountains beyond, the beacons. They'd played games of skill and strength and aim, always competing, always egging each other on. The motto of their childhood, anything is possible. Mary went to the target now, hauled the arrows out of the straw as James returned with his footballs in a net bag. Sparrows chirped in the greening trees, and high above, against the backdrop of the mountains, a peregrine falcon circled, eyeing up prey. James helped her to forget the stallion, but he also reminded her he was a de Courcy. How could he not? James dropped 5 footballs at her feet and played keepy-uppy with the 6th. He made it look effortless, bouncing the ball off his feet, his knee, his head. He was still able to glance at her and smile. Now what? You aim them at my target. Shoot for the bullseye, the gold, from 50 yards. He laughed. Nice one. Mary indicated the start point. James lined up a ball and sent it bulleting forward. With a bang, it thudded to the edge of the target. He grimaced, tried again, got the other edge. He muttered under his breath and just missed the gold with the 3rd, but nailed it with the 4th, 5th and 6th balls. Mary kept her face deadpan. Not bad. Your turn, he said, grinning. Mary picked up her longbow and walked back another 20 yards. Aiming from instinct rather than by sighting, she loosed 12 arrows. The bow thrummed softly, singing its song of death. 6 bullseyes, called James.
That makes us equal, according to my maths.
Double or quits, responded Mary,
wrenching the arrows from the target once more and dropping them into the forest green leather quiver, the length of a baguette and twice as thick, that hung from an attachment to her belt.
Okay, I'm on for that. What's the bet?
I bet, said Mary, head to one side, grinning evilly, that you can't hit the target from 100 yards.
Oh, come on, James exclaimed. Most pro footballers wouldn't be able to do that.
All the more reason for you to go for it, seeing as you want to be one. James blew out a breath.
All right, then.
I'll do that, and you can try and shoot the ball mid-air with an arrow, from a safe distance, he added hurriedly. Like 50 yards. Mary opened her mouth, closed it again. A static target was one thing. A moving one was something altogether harder. A ridiculous challenge. She'd never do it. She had to do it. She took her longbow and arrows and counted off 50 yards forward and 50 yards to the side as James walked back to the 100-yard point.
One ball, one arrow, Mary shouted out.
James sprinted forward and with his right foot propelled the ball skyward, just as Mary drew back her bow, tracked the ball, and released her arrow. She heard James shout as it thudded into the ball, punching it from the sky.
Happy, Longbow Girl?
He asked, with a clear mixture of admiration and irritation, as he jogged back to her. Mary shook her head. Not until you tell me why you got suspended. James gave her a pained look.
It's a long story.
Mary smiled. I'm not going anywhere. Come on, let's go and sit down. They walked to the bench Mary's father had positioned perfectly to take in the hillside view and sat side by side. Mary could feel the turmoil inside James, so she waited. This view always soothed her, and she knew it had the same effect on him. Just over a mile to their left on the valley floor was the village of Nanteos. 100 yards to their right was the Owen's cluster of stone buildings. The barn, the stables, and the two-story farmhouse where Mary lived with her parents and baby brother. Way off to the right, and higher up the hill, was the little whitewashed cottage of Saren Morgan, where Mary spent 2 hours a week in the cozy kitchen studying botany. Saren was the latest in a long line of herbalist healers, who were also said to have the gift of sight, the ability to see into the past and the future, and, worryingly, into people's minds. From odd incidents throughout her childhood, Mary felt sure this was true. Below them, emerald green fields dotted with oak trees and squared off by hawthorn hedges rolled down to the valley floor, where the Nanteos River emerged from the thick forest and meandered lazily through her family's lands and on through the village. Beyond that was the boundary wall of the de Courcy estates, then the manicured parklands, which rose up to the Black Castle, James's ancestral home. With its huge castellated walls, arrow slits and moat, it dominated the hillside opposite, glowering down on the valley and across to their farm. A reminder of the bloody past of this part of Wales.
It was football, of course, said James at last.
He turned to face Mary. There's this Russian guy, Alexei. His father's some oligarch, and he goes around saying things like, "If you upset me, my father'll have you taken care of." James's eyes blazed with quiet anger. So anyway, we were playing this match and competing for the same ball. I got it, ran on towards the goal, and then he comes in again with a slide tackle, studs up. "What?" yelled Mary. "He could have broken your legs." "Exactly," continued James. "So I told him what I thought of him. He punched me, and I punched him back." "Good on you," exclaimed Mary. "I hope you punched him harder." James gave a rueful smile. "I did, actually." The smile faded. The oligarch heard about it, made a complaint, so the school suspended me. To be fair, they suspended Alexei too. Mary blew out her breath. For how long? Till the start of summer term in 5 weeks? They let me play in the national school's final. I scored the winning goal, by the way, he added with a broad grin. Then they sent me packing. And what do they say back home? James frowned at the dark mass of the Black Castle. Then his eyes skimmed over the parkland, across to the flanking forests, and up to the bleak mountains where he'd roamed to escape his family. They say that if this is what happens when I play football, they're going to stop me playing. And coming over here too. Mary gasped. They can't do that. No, said James quietly, turning back to Mary. They can't. There was a look on his face Mary hadn't seen before. It was hard. A look of sheer determination, of someone who would go his own way, whatever the cost. Mary eyed him full on. What are you planning, James? I'll tell you when there's something to tell, he replied evasively. Mary was about to say something else when she saw her mother, Eleanor, striding across their lands. A Wellington-booted stranger following her. "Who's that?" asked James. Mary swore under her breath. "A buyer, come to sniff around our best brood mare. We have to sell her to buy a new stallion." "You know how I feel about this," said James. Mary knew he desperately wanted to help, but she also knew he had no funds of his own. As a means of trying to persuade him to knuckle down at school and follow the path they'd set out for him, his parents gave him hardly any cash. But even if he did have money, they both knew Mary would never have accepted it. "Like I said, not your fault." Mary looked away. "But I can't stand around and watch this. I'm off for a ride." She got up from the bench. "See you, James." "See you, Mary." "Stay out of trouble," she called over her shoulder. "You too." Mary gave a wry laugh. "I'll do my best." Chapter 2 James got up from the bench and walked slowly down the hillside. He watched from a distance as Mary rode Jacintha, her Welsh mountain pony, through the stream at the bottom of the valley. It was swollen with weeks of winter rain, and she lifted her boots high. He heard her laugh as the pony shook herself vigorously on the other side. Mary didn't use a saddle or a bridle unless riding in a show. Bareback felt more real, she said. and she had trained Jacintha and all the farm's Welsh mountain ponies, which had been the Owens' livelihood for centuries, to respond only to the gentle pressure on the halter. She didn't call herself a horse whisperer, said it was just kindness, patience, understanding, and a good-hearted pony. But to James it always seemed like magic. With Mary, Jacintha had become a major prize-winning show pony in the jumping and hunter classes. With her fine conformation, her jet-black coat, the white sock on her rear off leg, and the white star on her dished head, she was like a fairy tale image of a pony. She was fast and high-spirited. Mary loved her fiercely. At least it wasn't that horse who died, James thought now. Jacintha cantered across the valley, picking up pace now. Mary was lining up her pony, aiming at the boundary wall. Too high, surely, to jump. But Mary gathered in her pony, let her measure the distance, then threw herself flat over Jacintha's neck, so it seemed there was just one animal galloping away from him. The black pony leapt into the air. It looked for a second as if girl and animal were flying. Then Jacintha cleared the wall and landed safely on the other side. James rolled his eyes. Typical Mary. Having fun, pushing it, and making a point. He knew it was an act of defiance, her trespass. Not that he would ever see it as such. When his parents and sister were off the estate, Mary would often come round. But the de Courcys were all in residence, and this was Mary's not-so-subtle message to them. With her straight-backed poise and waist-length blonde hair streaming behind her, he thought that Mary looked more than ever like a marauding warrior princess. The Owens had been given Nanteos Farm in the 14th century. So long as each heir swore to protect the crown by the skill of the longbow. For 700 years, the Owen family had stood ready to do just that. And Mary was the first female heir. Now it had become an honorary concept. James couldn't imagine how the current queen would need a bodyguard archer. But without a longbow, Mary didn't know who she was. Maybe that was why she understood what football was to him. So much more than a sport or a game. But unlike Mary, he did not have the support of his parents. A career as a professional footballer was simply not an acceptable occupation for the Lord of the Black Castle. On one side was talent, yearning and ambition. On the other was snobbery, convention, and the weight of history. He sometimes wondered if he'd ever break free. Just before the boundary wall, James found the stallion's grave, marked by a simple headstone. He felt a slow burn of fury and shame as he tried to imagine the scene, if only to punish himself. Mary had witnessed the wolfhound's attack, had been the only one at home. She'd then had to shoot her own stallion, put a bullet in his head to end his agony. He couldn't begin to imagine how she'd felt. Wondered if their families would always hate each other. He jumped over the wall and accelerated up the hill at a sprint, trying to burn off his feelings. His father's Welsh black sheep, grazing decoratively, took fright at his approach and trotted away. The de Courcy flock had to be black to match the castle, his mother had often joked. But they were in fact an ancient breed. The castle records that his father obsessed over showed that the de Courcys had kept these sheep for over 500 years. Above him loomed the Black Castle, Castell Dŷ, built by his ancestors back in the 1200s. It looked like the fortress it was. Dark, forbidding, a statement of power, money and intent. But it was also a home, his home. He loved it, always had. He'd be sad to leave it. He glanced across the elegant parkland to check on Mary, hoping she'd jumped back onto the safety of her own lands. But she was still cantering on the wrong side of the wall, putting on her show of defiance, picking a fight, looking for trouble, almost as if she was summoning it from the cold spring air. He slowed down as he saw the slight but ferocious figure of his mother appear on the drawbridge that spanned the castle moat. She was scowling. "Can you believe it? That feral Owen girl trespassing on our land," she said. "Seeing is believing and all that, Ma." "I honestly don't know why you bother with her," the Countess continued. "Why don't you bring home some of your friends from school instead?" "There's a lot you don't know," James answered, refusing to engage in the fight his mother so clearly wanted. He walked under the portcullis, across the cobbled courtyard, up to the pair of phoenixes, the de Courcy emblem that guarded the great front door. He hauled open the oak, slammed it shut behind him. The boom echoed through the castle and down to the dungeons like a roll of thunder. Chapter 3. Mary crossed the de Courcy land. She knew she was barred. Could almost feel the Black Castle glowering down at her from its hilltop perch, and imagine the Earl de Courcy, binoculars pinned to his disapproving eyes, spying. Maybe he'd set the wolfhounds on them both. "He'd love that, wouldn't he?" she said into Jacintha's ear, and cantered on for another few hundred yards, making her point. She could see James crossing over the moat, disappearing under the teeth of the portcullis, and his mother. "Better go back, girl," she said to Jacintha at last. "Don't want you killed too." Safely over the wall and back on her own land, Mary hacked towards the Black Wood. It was an ancient forest, said to be thousands of years old. She wasn't sure if it had taken its name from the thickness of the trees, which on all but the sunniest of days seemed to turn day into night, all because of its proximity to the Black Castle. The forest spread across both the Owens' land and the de Courcy estate. The trees respected no boundaries, and there was no dividing wall within the forest itself. Mary spotted a narrow break and entered the trees, following a natural pathway, perhaps made by deer and her own ponies seeking shelter. The sun was warm on her face, and she could smell the sweet, earthy scent of her pony's sweat. Birdsong rang out. Thrushes, robins, finches. Mary was sure she heard a nightingale, after which the valley of Nanteos was named. But the notes of its song grew fainter, as if the bird was moving away, leading them deeper into the forest. With a light squeeze of her legs, Mary guided Jacintha to follow it. Jacintha was nervous. Ponies were prey animals, and the forest was anything but silent. The trees spoke to one another in surprisingly high-pitched squeaks as wood rubbed against wood in the gentle breeze. Pony and rider meandered off the path onto a smaller track. Mary ducked under low-hanging branches, gazing around her. She knew almost all her family's lands intimately, but this part she had never explored closely. Legend had it the forest was haunted. Looking around, Mary could almost believe it. Moss climbed up the tree trunks, shrouded the branches, fell in tendrils towards the earth, velvet green, pervasive, almost prehistoric. The nightingale fell silent. Jacintha stopped abruptly. "What is it?" asked Mary, looking around. "Not the wolfhounds," she prayed, fear flickering through her. She slid off Jacintha's back, grabbed a solid branch and, heaving on it, broke it off the tree with a loud crack that echoed round the forest. But Jacintha was still standing to attention, so Mary felt sure the wolfhounds were not there. She would have heard them by now, and Jacintha would be more frightened. So what was it? She led her pony forward, under an especially low-hanging branch. Ah, so that's it. Ahead of them was a huge, uprooted oak tree, its roots tilted skyward. Mary felt a pang. The oak was a healthy one, probably at least 400 years old. "What have you seen, old tree?" she asked softly. "Did the spring gales bring you down?" She hooked Jacintha's reins over a branch and went closer. The tree had fallen at a strange angle, over an oddly symmetrical mound of earth over 20 feet long and about 10 feet high. It looked man-made, like the burial mound she'd studied in her history lessons. The tree must have grown over the top of it. She skirted back to the roots. There was a huge gaping hole where the roots had been. Mary paused, tilted her head. Something was down there, a rectangular shape. Intrigued, she scrambled down, muddying her hands as she slipped. Then she reached down, worked on the earth, and pulled the object free. It was a small chest, the size of a large shoebox. She brushed off more dirt, revealing ornately worked metal. It looked very old. She felt a sudden weariness. Was this how Howard Carter and the Lord Carnarvon felt when they stood on the threshold of Tutankhamun's tomb, when they first caught the gleam of gold within? Before the supposed curse of Tutankhamun took Carnarvon's life 6 weeks later. "Don't be ridiculous," she chided herself. "It's just an old chest. In Wales." "Yes," said a competing voice, "but it might be from a tomb just the same." There was a clasp, rusty, rough-edged. Mary tried to prise it open, but it wouldn't yield. She fiddled, pulled, pried, cut herself, swore. Then, with something between a hiss and a sigh, the chest opened. Inside was an oblong bundle, covered in tatty cloth, the colour of old leaves. Biting her lip, Mary unwound the cloth. It spooled at her feet like the wrappings of a mummy. Inside was a book. It was ancient-looking, written in an elaborate, cursive script on pale parchment. She thought it looked like old Welsh. Some pages were illustrated with beautiful and detailed coloured drawings. Wow! What have we got here? Mary whispered, shivering slightly. Whatever it was, it must have been a treasured possession of whichever Welsh chieftain had been buried in the mound. She quickly wrapped up the book again and replaced it in the metal chest, then stood still, thinking. After a few minutes, she carried it back to Jacintha. The pony snorted and tossed her head. "Hey, it's all right, Jack," murmured Mary. "Nothing in here to hurt you." She stroked Jacintha's warm, muscled neck, soothing her. Then, unusually awkward as she clasped the chest under her arm, she stood on a branch of the fallen tree, mounted her pony, and rode from the forest. Jacintha was skittish all the way, shied at every sound. Bareback, encumbered by the chest, Mary nearly tumbled a few times. "Calm down, Jack," she crooned. "Everything's fine." Except that it wasn't. Chapter 4 Mary was a storyteller. Since she'd been a little girl, she'd come home from her adventures on the farm or in the hills and woods, with ever more outlandish tales to tell her parents. "I met a knight walking through the forest. In armour he was, polished silver, sword and all." Or, "Guess what? Jacintha jumped so high today she soared through the air. A gust of wind took us. Half a mile we went, right up the beacons." This story would be used to justify her being home half an hour late. The better it was, the more her parents excused her. Mary didn't know where she got it from. Certainly not her father. He believed in what he could see, nothing more. Longbow man. But her mother, a talented artist, liked to tell stories in her paintings. Vivid oils of dragons and harps and knights. Both her parents were sitting at the kitchen table, going over the farm accounts when she walked in. Her baby brother, Gawain, lay in his playpen, gurgling away under a baby gym. She hid the chest behind her back. "Guess what I found today?" Her father looked up. His face was somber, but when he locked eyes with her, it broke into a smile. He closed the file in front of him, pushed it away. "No. Let me see." He leant back in his chair, hands behind his head. "You fell down a well, and before you managed to haul yourself out, you discovered a hoard of Roman coins." Mary shook her head, grinning. "Not this time, Da." Her mother tucked her long, dark hair behind her ears and studied her quizzically. "A stranger. Wandering in the hills, you could have sworn you saw the outline of wings beneath his coat. You spoke to him for a while, then turned away for just a second, and when you looked back, he'd gone. Disappeared into thin air. You spent hours hunting for him, and that's why you missed lunch, isn't it, Spinner?" Mary laughed. Spinner was her mother's nickname for her. Spinner of tales. "Nice one, Mum, but no." She brought the chest from behind her back, set it on the table. I found this, she said, opening the chest and unwrapping the book with a flourish. Her parents eyed the book. Her father leant forward as her mother slowly turned the pages, her long white fingers delicate on the ancient parchment, silenced by a real story this time.
Where on earth did you find this, Cariad?
Asked her father. Cariad meant sweetheart in Welsh. Mary loved her parents' various names for her, made her feel that she was lots of different things. Get your boots on, said Mary. I'll show you. Her father carried Gawain in a sling across his chest. 6'4", he always walked at military yomp pace, eating up the ground. Mary and her mother were used to it. Reckoned a walk with him equaled a workout. When they got to the burial mound, they were glowing with a sheen of sweat. They paused. Around them the forest was silent now. No birds sang. Probably frightened away, thought Mary. Down there, she said, pointing to the hole in the ground. You can see the ship behind it, now the tree's blown over. It's got to be a burial mound. Her father cast his eyes over it.
I think you're right, Cariad, he said. You know, in all the years, I've never noticed it.
It's as if the tree was guarding it, said Eleanor, or hiding it. She paused and murmured. Maybe this is why they say the forest is haunted. Caradoc Owen gave her a brisk look.
Who's buried you? That's what I'd like to know.
Someone important, said Mary. Some chieftain or prince. Must be to have a book like that. We need to find out, Eleanor said. And we need to decide what to do with the book. We can't keep it hidden away in a cupboard.
Something like that belongs in a museum, said Caradoc.
Mary looked down at the burial mound, wondered if whoever lay there minded that she had taken their book. She shivered with a sudden sense that they did. Maybe digging around in tombs was not such a good idea. She thought again of the Valley of the Kings and the curse of Tutankhamun. Maybe we should just forget about it and put it back, she said hurriedly. Her parents gave her a strange look. Why? They asked in unison. Well, it belongs to whoever's down there.
He or she is long gone, said Caradoc. They shouldn't trouble you.
But they did. Come on, let's go home, Mary said. She didn't want to be near their skeletal remains any longer. Back at the farmhouse, her mother took her aside. You found the book. What do you think we should do with it? She asked. Mary shook her head. I'm not sure. Half of me really does want to bury it again, but the other half is curious. I want to know more. Look, Eleanor said, putting her hand on her daughter's arm. It's Saturday. No need to do anything for a few days. Just sleep on it. Mary did just that. When she went to bed that night, she pushed the chest containing the book deep under her bed. But she kept thinking back to the hole under the tree. When had the chest been buried? And who had owned the land then? The de Courcys or the Owens? She stood in her cosy, yellow-painted room with its two windows. One looking up the hill towards Saren's cottage, the other across the valley to the Black Castle. reliving the events of the day. So much had happened. James arriving home in turmoil. The buyer coming to look at their mare. Her discovery in the black wood. It had started off like any other day and turned into something different.
Life has a way of surprising us, Cariad,
her father was fond of saying.
Best be ready.
But what did that mean? All she was ready for was a war she'd never have to fight. A war of longbows and knights in armour. She opened her window facing the Black Castle for some fresh air. For a while she just stood there, breathing in the night, gazing across the black void to the castle, where distant lights glimmered. What was James doing? She wondered. More arguments with his parents? Or was he holed up in his room, avoiding them? She heaved out a sigh, closed her primrose-sprigged curtains, changed into her nightdress, and walked barefoot across the white-painted floorboards. There was a small rug in the middle of her room, but she liked the feel of the wood beneath her feet. She removed her eye patch, slipped into bed, and pulled the duvet and quilt up to her chin. Half asleep, half transported by her own imagination and by memories of the tale her father had told and retold many times. Her mind went back to the fateful battle nearly 700 years ago, when the ownership of the land changed, when her family's fortunes were made and the Owen's longbow tradition began. A battlefield in northern France. Courcys, 1346. The muscled archers hauling back their massive bows, sending up a hail of arrows that blackened the sky and brought death to the French and victory to the English. Against all odds. And 16-year-old Edward, the Black Prince, heir to the English throne, embroiled in close-quarter combat and fighting for his life. Saved not by the noblemen who were his close guard, nor the 4th Earl de Courcy, who commanded that guard, but by Mary's own ancestor, a longbowman who, with a well-aimed arrow, felled the man who was swifting an axe to the prince's head. And on that one arrow, the fortunes of the Owen family turned. The Black Prince rewarded Longbowman Owen with 500 acres of land and enough gold to build a modest cottage. 500 acres taken from the ancestral estates of the Earl de Courcy. A royal punishment that cut deep. The enmity between the two families started that day. Everyone knew the de Courcy still wanted back what they would always regard as their land. Its loss was an open wound, picked over by the generations so that it would never heal. In her dreams, Mary saw the chieftain rising from the burial mound, saw the flesh recladding his skeletal frame, saw the rich robes of his rank once again swathing his body as he marched from the dark forest across the open fields to reclaim his book. More than that, but to take back the Owens' land, their home, and return it to the de Courcys. Chapter 5. It was a Saturday. Her father was up, feeding Gawain spoonfuls of freshly mashed banana and avocado, giving Eleanor a much-needed lie-in.
"Morning, Cariad,"
he said. as Mary appeared in dressing gown and Uggs.
You all right?
Nope, said Mary. Headache. Her dreams had segued into nightmares and left her head throbbing.
Yeah.
Finish feeding this little monster and I'll cook us some pancakes with bananas and maple syrup. How about that?
Yes, please, said Mary, sitting down with a grateful sigh. Sweet, stodgy food was the best cure, and her father, despite being traditional in many ways, was a very good cook.
I like to eat, so I'd be stupid if I didn't know how to cook, was his response to anyone who expressed surprise.
10 minutes later, he handed Mary a full plate and a cup of hot chocolate.
Eat up, feel better. I'll see you outside in half an hour.
Mouthful, Mary nodded. Saturday mornings meant longbow practice with her father. Nothing got in the way except bad weather, and only then because it damaged the arrow's fletches and messed up the straw target. This was a very different exercise from the arrows she shot with James. Hanging out with him, larking around while he honed his football skills. Saturday practice with her father was where the longbowman handed down all his skills. Where he pushed her always to get better, stronger, and more accurate. Not for a war that would no longer be fought, but because it was part of who the Owens were, as essential to their identity as the land they lived on. Every year, he was required to demonstrate his prowess at the Royal Welsh Show, in front of the Prince of Wales. In a year, it would be Mary's turn. The longbowmen of the past were legendary, the most fearsome killing machine the Western world had ever seen. Their longbows had drawn weights of around 140 pounds. They could shoot their steel-tipped arrows from 200 paces with sufficient force to pierce armor, and could shoot so fast that they could send 3 arrows scything through the air at any one time. They won unwinnable battles, gained untold lands, struck terror into the hearts of their enemies. Songs had been written about them, stories woven about them. They were the game changers of their age. It was these ghostly giants of history that Mary and her father honored. She had started training aged 5. Her muscles and technique had been honed for over a decade. That was about as long as the archers of old took to develop their massive strength and skill needed to go to war with a longbow. Even though Gawain had come along, a wonderful surprise baby, his birth changed nothing. Mary was the longbow girl. Her parents wouldn't have dreamt of taking that away from her. Mary finished her breakfast, already felt better. She washed up, pulled on her boots, grabbed her bow, her leather arm brace and quiver, and walked out to their practice field. She removed the tarpaulin cover from the straw target and strapped the brace to her left arm. She'd gone without it a few times, and the bowstring had given her some wicked bruises. Most longbow archers wore a finger tab to protect their skin when drawing the bow, but she and her father often forgot their tabs and went without. She'd grown large calluses on the pads of her 2 forefingers as a result, but she didn't mind. Calluses were better than gloves or tabs. You didn't lose them. And besides, she liked to feel the bow cord and the arrow, to guide it with that extra bit of sensitivity. Her father approached from the house, holding 2 bows.
You can unstring that one, he said,
nodding to the bow that lay on the tarpaulin, and handed her another bow.
"You've grown again, Cariad. Time for a new one."
"Oh, da!"
Mary stood on tiptoe, kissed her father's cheek. The bow, her 11th, was beautiful. She'd had a new one every year, from the age of 5. And her father had made them all. Each bow was a surprise. She never knew when she'd get it. And seemed to have marked a watershed in her life. As if her father knew what was coming. Or perhaps as if having the new bow made something happen. He had also made the bow that had harboured the invisible, undetectable flaw. The bow that broke and took Mary's eye. He had never forgiven himself for that. And the smile he gave her as he handed her the new bow was tinged with a sorrow that never went away, no matter how many times Mary told him that it wasn't his fault, that he couldn't have known, that it was just bad luck. It was an archer's law that every bow, when fully drawn, was 9/10 broken. That all it took to cause a fatal rupture was one small weakness deep within the wood. A weakness that could lie dormant and invisible and undetected until it was too late. Like people, you never quite knew where the breaking point was. Mary weighed the new bow in her hand. She held it, one end hovering just off the ground, the other reaching just a few inches above her head. She prayed it was sound.
"Just right," said her father. "Here's the cord. Let's see if you can string the bow. 50-pound draw, mind you."
He would already have tested it, making the cord just the right length to give the bow the perfect draw length. Her perfectionist father. Mary slipped the knotted string over the lower nock, pulling it tight. She found a soft piece of ground to rest the lower nock on. Then, placing her knee on the handle of the bow, she pulled with her left hand until the upper limb bent towards her, while with her right hand she worked the loop of the string towards the groove of the upper nock. With a final surge of strength, she slid it in. She'd done it at the first attempt, no fumbling. Her father gave a slight nod. Mary smiled. She went through the routine that had become almost as familiar and as automatic as breathing. The longbowman's mantra, her father's mantra.
"Ready your bows. Knock. Mark. Draw. Loose."
The same words that would have echoed across the battlefields of the Middle Ages. She held the stave of her bow in her left hand, turned sideways onto the target.
"Ready your bows."
She braced her feet, hip-width apart, left foot forward in the archer's stance. She reached back her arm and pulled an arrow from her quiver, holding it by the nock at the end, the slit that kept it in place on the bowstring. With its shaft of cedar and its metal tip, the arrow was 27 inches long. It was fletched with goose feathers, like the arrows used at Courcys.
"Knock."
She clicked the arrow on the string, making it thrum softly.
"Mark."
She looked up, eyed the target, visualized the arrow slicing through the air, coming home to rest in the gold.
"Draw."
She bent over from the waist, then in a fluid motion, using the strength in her legs, stomach, back and arms, she straightened up and with her forefinger and second and third fingers of her right hand on the string. She pulled her arm back and up till the bow was at full stretch, until her hand was just under her ear, with her forearm parallel to the ground. Her back muscles bunched and strained, but she did it.
Loose!
The arrow was pulled back too far to aim by looking down its shaft. Instead, Mary just looked at the target, released her grip on the string, and let the arrow fly. The arrow thudded into the target, dead center of the gold. She glanced around the fields to the forest, where the chieftain lay, as if by her arrows, by her marksmanship, she could keep him at bay. Chapter 6. Mary spent the rest of the weekend with her family. Weekdays on a farm were always so busy that they all valued whatever quiet time they could get on Saturday and Sunday. There were still chores to be done, but Eleanor always made sure they all went on a family outing on both days, even if it was just a trip to Brecon. Monday morning came and Mary spent the morning on the PC, doing her distance learning courses. Today she focused on maths and the sciences. By lunchtime she was done. Her father had gone out. Stormed out, more like. She'd heard his raised voice as he took a call on his mobile. Then the slamming of the door and the acceleration of their ancient Land Rover as he drove off somewhere in a hurry. Her mother had taken Gawain to visit her sister in Brecon, so Mary got her own lunch. Tin tomato soup with grated cheddar and two slices of Saren's homemade bread. She still hadn't decided what to do about her book. It made her feel restless, sitting up there under her bed. It was as if it was giving off vibes. A text pinged in as she spooned up soup. James. What you doing? Lunch. You? Meant to be studying. Can't face it. Parentals aren't forcing you? Parentals have gone to Cardiff. Want to come round? I'll use the tunnel. What is it with you and the tunnel? Don't know. Just love it. Used to frighten you. That's the point. Weirdo. See you in the dungeons. Love the dungeons. Who's weird now? She'd show her book to James, Mary thought. That'd distract him from his woes. She cleared up lunch, then set off, the chest and her head torch hidden in a large plastic bag swinging at her side. She climbed the boundary wall, checking there was no sign of the wolfhounds, then headed towards the wilderness below the castle, where the gorse grew thick, concealing the entrance to the tunnel. The de Courcys escape tunnels were still a closely guarded secret, 800 years after their construction. Mary strapped on her head torch, switched it on, and pushed through the thorny bushes, ducking under the low entrance. Inside, it was cold and damp. The beam of her torch bounced off the walls of the glistening black rock. As she went deeper into the tunnel, her footsteps echoed so it sounded like she was being followed. She glanced around a few times, just to check, even though she knew nobody'd be there. The tunnels always did that, spooking her. Maybe it was the unquiet spirits of all those who'd walked this way before. As always, Mary was relieved when she got to the door that led into the castle dungeons. She tapped lightly, and it opened immediately. James stood there eyeing her plastic bag quizzically. What you got in there? Wait and see. Come on, then. You can show me in my room. Mary pulled off her muddy trainers and socks and left them with her torch beside the door. Barefoot, She walked behind James, through the dungeons, past the cells, now used to store wood and coal and odds and ends. She saw lampstands, an old upright pram, a fire grill, and two ladders. The iron bars were still there, though. She paused, reached out, took hold of one. Was there a flutter in the air? An echo of a movement long ago? Or was she spinning again? Something ran through her. She shivered and let it go. They filed up the narrow spiral staircase, came out into the cavernous great hall. In the dim lighting, Mary thought she saw someone on her blind side, turned sharply. James laughed. Just Sir Lancelot? Mary blew out a breath and studied the life-size figure of the knight in full chainmail, complete with helmet and sword.
God, he always gets me.
Gets the dogs too, remarked James. They still growl at him. They walked across the age-darkened slate floor, buffed smooth over the centuries, and headed up the broad staircase. From the dark wood panelling, generations of de Courcys glowered down from their massed portraits. At the bottom, the most prominent, was the current Countess, the 21st, James's mother. Anne de Courcy was a girl from Swansea.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.